Whiskey's in some trouble. That's going to be Baron's to curve and sign a TS. Malnai's able to find the fight. Sneaky damage is monstrous, but Broken Blade's able to shut him down. The follow-up damage is there from Niski, and Smoothie will gobble up his teammate on the wall as Kumo grabs a goal unstoppable.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to Inside Esports. I'm Matt Hempstead, and as usual, on Monday, we're focusing all about League of Legends. Over in Europe, Fnatic lost their perfect record, but we're not worrying about Europe today. Today is all about the LCS because, my God, there were some absolutely crazy games. So before we get MarkZ on the line to talk all about it, let's get caught up with the highlights.
Over the wall to keep himself alive as Shelly is stolen by Impact. He runs up, he grabs the eye, he's about to stamp out that spider, and Wiggly shut down. Devil is very far forward, but he's able to just bait CLG in. They don't have the damage just yet. Devil's gonna be taken low, taken down. Team Liquid are winning the fight for now, but Ruin is rampaging through their lines. Biofrost gobbles him away, but still gonna be in some trouble. Strixhaze chased down by Devil, who goes deep into enemy territory. A double kill over to him, and that is the game! Liquid will remain at number one. Cloud9 coming in, trying to find a second one here onto Akaadian, but the equalizer will burn Zazel to the ground. Bjergsen's grabbing a kill on that one, but a big cataclysm's gonna trap TSM again. Baron at one quarter HP. Sven nearly killed again, but nearly's not gonna be enough. Sven taken very low. Bjergsen exploded. Cloud9 are still gonna find the fight. They've got two. Niski's in some trouble. That's gonna be Baron's secure, but a sign of TSM. Cloud9's able to find the fight. Sneaky's damage is monstrous, but Broken Blade's able to shut him down. The follow-up damage is there from Niski, and Smoothie will gobble up his teammate over the wall as Kumo grabs a goal unstoppable. Nexus turret number two is down. World Ender is up. Cloud9 continues the push. Nexus needs a couple more, and Cloud9 takes the win.
Yeah, as Adele just said, that was quite the comeback by Cloud9. And to help us figure out how C9 pulled it off, let's welcome in League of Legends analyst MarkZ. How's it going, man?
It's going pretty good. How about yourself?
Not too bad. Obviously, we need to talk about the big match of the week. Anytime C9 plays TSM, it's always a big deal. And this time, it looked like TSM was going to cruise to the win. But obviously, Cloud9 pulled it back from like a 7K deficit and stole the win. So how did they get that done exactly?
I mean, a large part of that was off the back of Sven Skarren. I mean, obviously, anytime someone comes back from a game like that, the team that threw it's going to have made a lot of mistakes. But this is one of the times where I felt like it was also a lot of C9 playing really well. There was one engage in the mid lane in particular where they were able to find Sven, who was separated from Smoothie, and then they had a great TP flank at the same time while Bjergsen was split from the team. And so they had a really good opportunity, and they saw that opportunity and brute forced it. It was pretty different in my mind than the CLG one, where, you know, it's very similar story, 7.8k ahead, they lose it, but that was just because Biofrost kind of killed himself in the mid lane. This was one where it was C9 actually forcing this comeback onto TSM.
One other guy that stood out to me in that game was Kumo, because we don't really see him on Jace, but this time he actually got a different champion. He played Aatrox, and to me it was a huge part of that C9 comeback. How do you think they've been able to incorporate him so well into the starting lineup after Licorice went out with an injury?
I think one thing that happens when C9 brings a new player in is they do their best to accommodate that new player. Some teams, when they bring in a rookie or someone who's relatively unproven, they'll say, okay, we're not going to put you in carry situations. You're not going to be the focus of the team. You just have to slot in and not throw the game. But what C9 likes to do is they like to say, okay, you play your most comfortable thing. If that's Jace, you're going to play Jace. We're going to play around you. And so they were constantly giving him attention and giving him this Jace pick, which is lane dominant. So they're saying, here's an easy matchup. We're going to give you resources. Don't worry about it. The rest of our team is so good that they can adapt to this new player coming in. And so they more often adapt the rest of the team to the new player than the new player to the rest of the team. And that allows that new player to shine.
Right, and over on TSM, I mean, sure they didn't win the game, but it seems like they have their jungling situation kind of sorted out. It seems like Akaadian has kind of earned the starting gig, even though earlier in the split, it was Grig who was performing a little bit better. So why do you think Akaadian is now the guy getting more playing time for TSM?
I think a large part of it actually was due to Rift Rivals. I don't know if Akaadian is the starter without Rift Rivals, but, you know, Akaadian was in the one time they picked up their win in Rift Rivals, and it was a very aggressive game plan where they're playing Elise and really just hard forcing, and Akaadian had a great game. And I think that Grig's a more consistent jungler. He's better with controlling. He even has good carry games as well, but he doesn't have that kind of pop-up potential and is not as good about just brute forcing plays. And when they went up against other top teams, you know, in the world, they realized we can't just go for this control-y game plan that's a lot slower. So, you know, even though it was only one game that we saw on stage, they definitely had a ton of scrims. And I assume it was kind of similar there where when you're playing against these other fast-paced, aggressive teams, you need someone like Akaadian in there to actually go toe-to-toe with them.
Okay. So last week, CLG beat TSM for the first time in over 3 years, you know, so all the fans are really excited, yeah. Super hyped about being up there in the standings. And then this week, they go 0-2 with losses to Liquid, and you already mentioned the interesting throw against the Golden Guardians. So it seems like a typical CLG situation where they give their fans hope just to bring them all crashing back down to earth. What's your take on this week from CLG? Because they did play okay for moments.
It was you know, a hot and cold week for me. Like, I appreciated seeing PoE not on a control mage. He busted out the LeBlanc. He was 6-1 on it, had a 20 stack mage eyes. You think the game is over. And then I don't know where they lose. And so you kind of walk away from it being like, well, I was glad to see them branch out. And it's not like LeBlanc lost in the game, but if they had Victor, maybe they still win it, you know, or something like that. Yeah. And you start playing that kind of game. I think CLG is in a good spot still, though, all things considered, especially with the fact that there are some other playoff teams slipping. I'm really not concerned for CLG. Yeah, they lost a game versus Golden Guardians, which would be great to pick up and kind of push that sixth place team further away from you. Yeah. But at the end of the day, like, that was a game that they were up 7.8k gold off their own plays. And so I think that they should still be relatively happy with where they're at. And fans should cut them a break.
Yeah, I mean, especially with teams like GGS and Optic kind of slipping, they're still in a good spot. And another team that's kind of creeping up in the standings is 100 Thieves. You're repping the jersey, you're repping the sweater. You know, for a while I thought they might go winless, but all of a sudden, since Ryu and Fake God came in, they're 5-3. It seems like Bang and Afro have really stepped up their aggression too. So how has Amazing Ryu and Fake God kind of helped to free up the bot lane so they can really pick up their level of play? Because it's night and day from where it was earlier in the split.
Yeah, I think there's a level of... There's a couple things. One, I think when Amazing came over, even though they didn't have all the other players in quite yet, he was clearly very passionate. He was fiery. He wanted to win in his interviews. And on the heist, you could see that he was not okay, just kind of limping through the season. When Ryu and Fake God came in, Ryu's a very good player in terms of shot calling and knowing where to be on the map. And that combined with Amazing being a very aggressive and, you know, a good communicator, they started to formulate a game plan, and it feels like that game plan has become, we're going to sack top lane, Fake God, you're going to play, you know, without very many resources and probably going to lose a lot of lanes, but we're going to camp from Afro and Bang for the most part. And that's where most of their jungle attention and mid lane roams down more often now. Soligo is a young guy and doesn't seem to quite have the understanding of how to move on the map to affect the game quite like Ryu does. And so by putting Ryu in, comboing with another veteran and Maurice, Amazing, they know now how to get to bot lane at the right times. And you can see, like, before, the stats for 100 Thieves bot lane, and Bang was down like 1.1k gold at 15 every game average, and now he's up like 500. And so it's a massive swing in the bot lane performance, because it feels like the team has landed on a playstyle that is playing more heavily around Afro and Bang, which was also more reminiscent of when they were good in spring last year, was Meteos and Ryu moved down to play around Cody and Afro. So it feels like kind of a return to form for them.
Definitely looks like it, and they're looking like they might sneak into the playoffs the way they're playing right now. I've got one really hard-hitting question for you, Mark, because I know you've been kind of grinding the teamfight tactics, obviously.
Okay.
It's brand new, okay? So how have you been able to keep up with League and the LCS now that teamfight tactics is out here destroying lives and making so much noise?
I mean, luckily for me, I have a lot of free time. So I get to, you know, I read Reddit all the time. I'm always seeing the interviews, what's going on. I watch a bunch of leagues. And then I also just have a lot of time that I spend usually like watching anime and movies and Netflix. And now that time is what I've taken and destroyed for TFT. I haven't touched my League of Legends analysis time.
There you go. Just gotta move your timeline a little around to fill in that TFT. Mark, mm-hmm. Appreciate you so much for joining us to chat LCS. Thanks a lot, and keep up that TFT grind, man.
Thanks, and I hope it goes well for you too. Rank's coming out this week.
Oh boy, I'll get ready for it.